Welcome back to another NBA playoff edition, Knockdown, Jay. I'm joined this week, Steven Jackson, the people's champion.
There we go.
One of my favorite players during his prime. Steven Jackson, we got a lot to sift through here after two great Game 7s on Sunday. Let's get started with the 76ers. Yeah. Oh, brutal loss. Raptors win it on the Kawhi Leonard shot at the buzzer. Today, everybody's talking about the future of the 76ers. Mm-hmm. Steven, do you think they should run it back? Should they look to blow up the nucleus? What's the move here if you're the Philadelphia 76ers?
Well, they lost, you want to go down to the wire, Game 7. So they put that left everything on the court. But in order to get better and go on to the next season, you have to make a move. And I think the move is Ben Simmons.
Ooh.
I think they have to make a move where they can get more guards that can shoot and that can play in pick and roll. And I think Brooklyn has those two guards. I think with the package of two young guards that can shoot, dribble, penetrate, make plays, along with Jimmy Butler, Tobias Harris, and Embiid that gets doubled more than any big man in the game, I think that'll be special. I think it hinders them not having a point guard that can shoot because Embiid demands so many double teams that the normal shot and the perfect shot out of double team, as you know, is swing, swing, shot in the corner. Ben Simmons is always diving. And when you're diving into the defense because the defense is rotating your way. It kills the offense. Having two guards, maybe a D'Angelo Russell, maybe another guard from Brooklyn, I think that would be a dangerous
team. So you're
team.
Willing to give up
I'm
a
willing,
22-year-old rookie of the year.
That won't even shoot, yes. I sure am.
Again, people have compared him to Magic Johnson when he came into this league with his court vision, his passing ability.
Magic, no.
A 6'10 no. point guard, not a lot of those in the history of the NBA, Steven. If you
What did Magic do his rookie year?
Magic did game 6 against the Sixers, filled in at center in the NBA Finals, had like 42 points. Oh. Ben Simmons took 4 shots in game 7.
Exactly.
Yes.
You can't compare him to Magic.
But the potential, I'm loath to get rid of Ben Simmons at this stage. Now, I agree with the shooting. Mm-hmm. Do you think a move of Ben Simmons would be enough to keep Jimmy Butler, who is going to be commanding big bucks from several teams, the Lakers perhaps, in free agency this summer?
Well, I think that would be my main priority because he's a tough-nosed guy. He brings the energy and the leadership to the team, the experience, the tough-nosed, hard-nosed guy. He can play on both ends. He's one of the top 3 two-way player in the game. You got to lock him in first. I think he's a big part of that team. I think Embiid wants him on the team because it gives him more confidence and more security. But not having Jimmy on that team is going to create a big hole on that team, something that he filled this year. And I don't think they can go backwards on that note.
And regarding the coach, Brett Brown, down the stretch, the Sixers were awful in the fourth quarter. I believe they had back-to-back 24-second violations in a tie game with 2 minutes left. Do you think he survives this offseason? Again, the coaching market, as the Lakers just found out, we'll get to them shortly, it's very thin. I mean, Cleveland just hired John Beilein from college. He had never coached in the NBA. What do the Sixers do with Brett Brown? I don't want to put you on the spot and say fire. You know, they went to game seven down the wire.
Well, I mean, obviously, he didn't control the game at the end like he should have on the road. I think the players made plays. But I think for the most part, he's not the coach for them to me because he's not holding Ben Simmons accountable for getting better, creating a jump shot, making your team better. Because by you not having a jump shot at the point guard position, you're hindering our whole offense. And to have a coach that's not holding the player accountable, I have no respect for him.
Okay. All right, let's move on. Golden State Warriors have just announced Kevin Durant, Stephen, will not play in the first two games of the Western Conference Finals. So the Warriors, they're heavy favorites to take down the Blazers. Your thoughts on whether or not Golden State is susceptible against Portland without the best player in the NBA, I'll call him.
Well, I don't think they're a championship team anymore without KD. Obviously, they still can win games, as we've seen.
Yes.
You still have to go out there and win a series. Dame and them are playing real well. They're real confident, and they're playing well. They just went into the number 2 seeds home on the Game 7 and got a big win. So they're a very confident team. I wouldn't say Golden State is going to win this series without KD, but the simple fact that I was a part of an 8 seed that beat a 1
seed. Yes.
So anything can happen. With KD, it's kind of solidified. But without KD, I think Portland is real confident, and they feel like they can come in there and steal a game 1 or 2.
The narrative online, and again, you don't want to read too much into social media, but you're active on there, is that, well, hey, Warriors won 73 games without Kevin Durant a few years ago.
They just
knocked off the Rockets.
They also came back 3-1.
I would agree. Trust me, I'm on your side in this. But what do you want to say to the people who are like, hey, they just beat the Rockets in game 6 on the road? again, it's like a five-quarter sample size without Kevin Durant. This is a team with no bench. I know Quinn Cook and Jordan Bell played nice minutes in Game 6, but this Portland bench is much deeper. Rodney Hood.
Yeah.
I mean, Zach Collins right now is better than anyone on the Golden State bench.
Yes.
I think they're in real trouble if Kevin Durant doesn't show up in the series. They could lose this series if they don't have Kevin Durant.
It's definitely possible. Like I said, the Portland is playing confident. I think Steph and Klay are definitely way more aggressive without KD on the court. I think the numbers are when KD and Steph on the court, Steph averages 18. Without KD on the court, he averages 35. So it's a big difference.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So those guys are definitely more dangerous, and hopefully the guys off the bench can give them something to make up for missing KD. But it's going to be a good series, and I think if Portland was confident, they're more confident now, knowing they're going into the first two games without KD.
Yeah, certainly. All right, moving on to the Los Angeles Lakers. They just hired Frank Vogel over the weekend. We don't need to look into his resume. He was a massive failure in Orlando. Orlando made the playoffs the year after he left.
Right.
They also hired Jason Kidd as an assistant. We know in Milwaukee struggled. They've get rid of him, and now they're the number one seed in the East. Is Frank Vogel going to be successful with the Lakers?
I don't think so. I think it's going to be the same type of situation with Luke. If we looked at last year, a lot of the players, we looked in the media, how many times we heard about players going at Luke? Because there's no respect. Yeah, you played in the NBA, but you wasn't that good. You wasn't a star player. I think all the players going to gravitate to J-Kidd. They're going to love J-Kidd. LeBron's relationship is going to be with J-Kidd. He's going to talk to Vogel through J-Kidd. J-Kidd is going to be everything to that team. All the players going to gravitate to him. That's why I say players are the best coaches. I think it looks kind of shady to me, because what are you saying? You're saying you want Vogel to get the credit, but you want J-Kidd to develop the players?
Yeah.
Like, what are you saying?
The big story was when LeBron walks into a room, he needs to respect
Vogel
his head
and
coach.
LeBron could be right there. Yeah. I guarantee you walk to J-Kidd first.
Exactly. And that's going to ultimately be a big problem. I mean, David Blatt ran into that in Cleveland with Ty Lue as his assistant. I don't know. Why were the Lakers and Jeannie Buss afraid to hire Jason Kidd? Do you think it's some of the baggage off the court that he brought to the table? It doesn't really make sense why they would be so hot for him but not want to make him the guy.
Yeah, I don't think it was anything baggage. I just think they got the wrong people running the organization.
Yes.
I mean, that's basically what it is. I mean, Magic walked away for a reason. He's seen a whole bunch of nonsense going on. And then at the end of the day, you know, even with Kurt Rambis, if he decides to come down and coach, they're not going to respect him either.
Yeah.
You know, and that's just what it is. But for the most part, it just looks bad.
Now, I don't want to go overboard with a coaching hire impacting free agency, but does Kyrie Irving, Kawhi Leonard, those type players, Jimmy Butler, see the hire of Vogel and say, I don't want to go there? Or are we overrating coaching when it comes to free agency?
That's why they hired J-Kidd, because they see exactly what you said. They see the hire of Vogel and be like, well, they got J-Kidd there.
Yeah.
So work.
Hall of Famer, all-time great point guard. All right, Steven, we'll get you out of here on picks. Milwaukee Bucks, Toronto Raptors. Bucks haven't played in about a week by the time game one comes around.
Yeah.
I will give you this. Pascal Siakam in four games against the Bucks this year destroyed them. Mm-hmm. They don't have a matchup for him. Averaged 24 a game, shot over 40% from three. Giannis, obviously, versus Kawhi. Do you think the Raptors are live underdogs in this series? The Bucks are heavy favorites to get to the finals.
Well, I think the series can go either way. It depends on who defends the best. Greek Freak and Kawhi are both relentless guys on offense. They're going to attack all game. We're going to see what different combinations they can throw at each guy. I think for the most part, Toronto has different guys they can throw at Greek Freak and give him different looks. I think Ibaka can be more physical with him. Siaka can guard him on the wing and on the post. He's big enough. It's just about competing. I don't think Kawhi would be on him too much, because you don't want to get Kawhi in foul trouble, and you really need him on offense. But I think they have other guys that can come off the bench that probably can bang with him a little bit. But defense is going to be the total factor of the game, and you have a great coach that coaches great defense in Milwaukee. I played for him in San Antonio, Mike Budenholzer. He's a great defensive coach, and that might get them
over. Yeah, they were number one in the regular season.
And he knows Kawhi.
Efficiency. Yes, let me ask you quickly about that. When you look at the matchups, if Kawhi, who did everything in that Sixer series, has to guard Giannis and then come around and provide all the scoring, he's going to be gassed. We saw him in Game 7. I think he put up 39 shots.
Yes.
If he has to carry that load, Steven, they're going to have no chance in the series. Well, who steps up other than Siakam? I mean, can Kyle Lowry actually show up? Because he's got a tough matchup with Bledsoe. Wait, Danny Green?
If you see, he didn't guard Jimmy Butler in the series either. They always put him on a smaller guard. So I think they'll put him on Bledsoe and let Siakam and some other guys get the first cracks at Greek Freak, but for the most part, you want him fresh. And Toronto has to figure out other ways for other guys to score. Bud is going to do a great job of taking Kawhi out of sweet spots and taking the ball out of Kawhi's hand. That's something Pop has taught him and something he's good at. He's going to make Kawhi do a lot of things different. And I really believe that if it's a coaching battle, you got to go towards the Milwaukee coach. He has the experience. He has the championships. And he knows Kawhi. Watch the games he play. I think it's going to be something Kawhi's never seen.
Let's give Nurse some credit, though. In Game 7, Ibaka, who had a rough series. Every time Embiid ate him up, Serge Ibaka was a monster on the offensive glass. And that's a great point. He could match up with Giannis and maybe slow him down, although I don't know if anybody can slow him down.
And when you talk about coach, you talk about Brett Brown. Last play of the game, you can't let Kawhi go right. Force him left.
Do we want to pin that on Ben Simmons? He kind of gave up and handed him off.
I said Brett Brown.
Yeah.
Coaches, after the timeout, that's one thing Pop was good at, tendencies, letting you know guys' tendencies. Coming out of timeout, they should have told him. Whenever he catch the ball, if he makes a game winner, make it go left. They let him go all the way right, all the way to a sweet spot. Yeah, you got to know your tendencies.
All right, and quickly, Portland versus Golden State. Again, the Kevin Durant injury out the first two games. If Portland steals one, we know they have a big home court advantage up in the Northwest. For some reason, I think they can win this series if Kevin Durant is not 100%.
If Kevin Durant misses more than two or three games, it's a chance. It's possible that they can. But they have to win it. I don't think they can expect just Golden State to lay down just because KD's not out there.
Yeah.
Portland still has to play lights out basketball. They have to shoot well. They have to defend in order to beat Golden State without KD. For the simple fact that they still have a dangerous team. They're still a championship team. For the most part, I want to see how Dame performs.
Yes.
I want to see how Dame, he kind of took a step back in this series against Denver.
Did he look a little tired in game
seven? Yeah, because he used so much energy going up against Russ.
Yeah.
He kind of set back, but that's good having a teammate
like
you have. He can take over sometimes.
I mean, they called the play for McCollum in a one-point game down the stretch. That was impressive.
And every time they came down, they got the ball in the last 3 minutes, Damian slowed it down and gave it to McCollum because he knew he was going. And that's what good players do.
But Dame is an Oakland guy, right? And you wonder if in the first two games he's going to be out to kind of prove something. Hey, I'm on Steph Curry's level. I was first team All-NBA last year. This is my hometown. He did drop 40 on the Warriors this season in a game. I think some of the matchups actually could favor Portland. Not Dame against Curry, obviously, but the depth could be a problem for Golden State.
Well, it's going to be more dangerous than James to me for the simple fact that they're in the system, and they're attacking in the system.
Yes.
When you're ISOing, you know what's coming. You can see what's coming. Everybody can see on the paint. It's just ISO ball. They score in the system, and they got multiple guys that can score, and they're more dangerous. I like this series. This series is going to be way more entertaining than the Houston series.
All right, there you have it, folks. Another edition of Knockdown Jay in the books. For Steven Jackson, I'm Jason McIntyre. We'll see you next week.